As Lyle said, we're the last panel here. We'll try to take a little bit more of a look into the future, and also, Joe, we'll try to open up at the end for some Q&A as well. The last few minutes. So just have all the panelists introduce themselves.
Hi, Greg. You want to sit next to Adam? Hi, Tara. Nice. And then you could sit next to. Great. Okay. Perfect.
We meet again.
Hi. So that's the way we do it at MediaPost. We like the names of the people to actually fit their faces on the slide. But you know everybody in this room, so. Thank you for having me. I'm a little more laryngitis right now than I normally am, so my elocution's always low, so I'll try and speak up. Just like yell if you can't hear me. So that was a great panel, and I would just like to do like a lot of follow-up questions to that last panel, but I know the goal right now is to really kind of end the day with the future. It's great that there's still a packed audience here, that you guys are all eager and really want to know how to get to this solution. I'm going to try not to editorialize. I have a lot of opinions about this business, but you know, you really want to hear from the experts, so I'm here as a moderator on behalf of CIMM, but I might deviate. So we'll start with just quick introductions. You know who these people are, and then I'll ask an opening question. So from my left, your right, we have Julian Zilberbrand, who is the Executive Vice President of Data for Viacom, which is great that there's even a title like that in a major media company. So it's a recognition of how important it really is. Adam Gerber, who is Senior Vice President Strategy for ABC Television. We have Greg Pharo, who's Global Director of Media Analytics and Advertising Research for the Coca-Cola Company. We have Tara Walpert Levy, who's Senior Vice President, Agency and Media Solutions for Google. And we have Jonathan Steuer, who is Chief Research Officer of Omnicom Media Group. So it's a good representation of client, agency, and media supply. And thankfully, no research suppliers on the panel. Okay. So, no, I mean, honestly, I think it makes it more
recovering.
Neutral. I'm sorry. Oh, you are a research
I'm
supplier.
A recovering researcher.
Oh, yeah. Right. Fair enough. We won't hold your past transgressions against you.
Okay.
So I'd just like to open up with the general question just to kind of ease us into the conversation, which is if there were one thing you could suggest we do right now that will get us to this better future, what would you recommend we do? And let's do this linear, because we're talking about a nonlinear medium now.
I guess that means me first. I think the last panel talked a little bit about this, but further levels of standardization that we truly need from a data perspective across the board. People need to be speaking the same language when it comes to information. I don't think that's the case today. I think that there's efforts to do so, and there's a lot of varying industry organizations that are moving in that direction, and CIMM's a really great example of ones that are trying to do that and are making significant progress, but that's, to me, one of the main missing links.
Thank you.
I think the answer depends on what we're talking about, whether we're talking about kind of traditional currency measurement or whether we're talking about kind of this future state of where we want to be around performance. But let me try to answer it around the future state of performance and some of the things that have been talked about today. I mean, look, there is I agree with everything Julian just said about standardization and kind of getting some parity between how we measure digital and traditional TV. But there's a huge gaping hole surrounding kind of this notion of identity and how we understand household level information in a way that enables us to, in a privacy compliant way, marry that to customer file data, third party data sets, et cetera. And I think as we talk about moving down the road of getting more performance oriented, if we don't solve the problem of the gatekeepers and not having a standardized way to look at the entire national footprint of homes from an identity perspective, we're lost.
Okay.
Well, I would certainly agree that that identity tracking is important, data standardization is important, but I would back up a little bit. You know, there are many different initiatives going on, many different agendas out there, and that complexity has been the enemy of trying to move things forward. I like the idea of locking everyone in a room, okay? Turn off the AC, turn off the water. Yes, I think you're onto something there. In other words, I think that there's an importance to be able to take a deep breath and then see about having closer coordination, agreement on what you want to tackle, agreement on how you're going to get there. In other words, align.
So I think while we're stepping back, I guess, to build on the points you guys have made, which I would agree with, you know, the question is who's in the room? And I think one of the biggest things we can do is to start to break down what I think for our industry has been a bit of an artificial construct, right? I hear a lot about, well, but TV versus online video and how do you compare and this and that. And the reality is that it's clear now from all of the data that viewers don't see online video and TV as separate silos. And I think if we want to be successful as brands and as publishers and as agencies, then neither should we.
So I want to say first, I do want to be in the room where it happens, when it happens. And also, for those who know me, I almost never say this, but building on what everybody else just said, and especially I think Kate did a good job of saying, the first thing we need to standardize on some level is what questions are we trying to answer? And then what this panel has, I think, added to that is there also needs to be standardization on what data we're gonna have access to measure those things and to give all the constituents in the different parts of the chain access to that data. And I mean, there may be different limits applied to that and there may be different ways that different parties get to access it. But I think where we are now is there are only a couple of comprehensive data sets and neither of them is fully mature. There are tons of little pieces all over the place that, to use the word from the last panel, need to be cobbled together. And I feel like in some ways I'm the chief research cobbler. And it's putting people in a room to decide both to decide what happens next. And then I think the piece of advice that I'd offer that comes out of this is to not fear that at some point there's going to be a discontinuity between the way we did it in the past and the way we need to do it going forward. And if we all figure out when that's going to happen and agree on it before it does, then we can manage toward it and forward from it when it happens. And I think where we are now is we keep trying to retrofit and adding another room onto the house. And I mean, as I think we saw from Andy's architectural diagrams on what cross-media measurement looks like, it's really complicated, and I don't think any of us want to live in the house that gets built if the way we build it is by adding on and adding on and adding on.
Okay. Well, I heard standardization, I heard identity, universal identity, in fact. I heard complexity and the closed door room and several times. And so this is a closed room, and the doors are pretty
The doors
closed.
Lock.
We need water, though.
There's no water.
I'm afraid.
So the next question I was going to ask was what are the next steps we could take to get there? But between listening to that last panel and your opening here, something struck me. It looked to me like we're always trying to cobble together solutions by industry marketplace coming to the people who need those solutions. And it's worked a long time. And I don't understand, I'm going to say the dirty word, why the industry doesn't organize in a more collective way. And I'm going to say it, why don't we consider a JIC approach? Because it seems like, I did not plan
that was a fan over there,
but I knew he was in the audience. But by that, you know, it seems reasonable and rational that if you want to come to common standards of what we're measuring, common standards of what identity constitutes, common standards about whether we're looking at performance or quantitative measurement or whatever it is, you could best do it by designing an industry design and then sourcing it out to the best providers. And I know it was attempted some years ago in a very simpler time for television. And I don't understand why that wouldn't be a logical solution here. And I know it's politically incorrect, but if you don't mind, indulge me and I won't ask any other Joe Mandese questions.
I think in theory it's certainly correct. In practice, I think there are fundamental challenges. You know, people and organizations look out for their own interests, right? We're in a capitalistic society, and I think that's inherently a challenge in that approach, and that's the fatal flaw in trying to attempt that. If everybody can kind of push that aside to a certain extent and align and try to work together for a singular purpose, then yes, of course. But if it then ends up costing you money, how do you approach that? And if that ends up costing money and jobs and everything else that could potentially come from that, from an individual company standpoint, I believe that, you know, that's fundamentally a barrier. So again, in theory, that makes a whole hell of a lot of sense. I think in practice, people need to put aside some financial needs that they have, and whether or not that's feasible, you know, I might not be the person to answer, but I would imagine that's a challenge right off the bat.
You know, it's interesting, because I do think that's been historically a lot of the challenges, particularly in the U.S., right? So it was referenced earlier, lots of similar approaches around the world, and quite frankly, you know, we're very involved in a number of other markets in doing exactly this, mm-hmm. and have had a lot of success with that. Some of the work in Germany about sort of bringing everyone to the table and frankly defining what questions are we trying to answer is really moving the ball forward. The thing that I wonder about in terms of the practicality is I do think the transformation in consumer behavior and sort of the resulting pressure, right, from advertisers on traditional video providers, on new video providers, is actually ironically aligning our interests more than it ever has before,
right?
Because we all need a transparent, trusted, seamless, easy way to sort of capture a value across a common ecosystem, which, by the way, we, again, share because TV's gone multi-platform. All the things that we digital providers care about, you know, you're increasingly caring about because it hits your business model, too. And so I do wonder, like, is now the time to sort of try that again?
And, I mean, from the point of view of who's going to pay for it, I think the reality is, at least on the buy side, we're paying for it now. And we're paying for it because we don't know what's actually happening, and so we don't know where our money's going. So I'm all for it. Let's go. The challenge, I think, if you look at other, at the structure of a JIC, is you have to maintain the ability for the organization to move fast and to follow the rate of change of technology that's shifting the way viewership is changing. And historically, big coalitions have not done well at that.
Which big player is breaking down the walled garden first?
Right.
Let's start with that one.
Well, I think the problem you have is that there, I mean, look, the last few years we've seen some massive M&A, and I think investments were made assuming a value proposition of the data sets and the ecosystem that was being purchased. And I think what you're proposing potentially dismantles that value in a lot of cases. So I think there's inertia just from that standpoint, I think, in terms of what's been done in the marketplace. But I think the other is, look, there'll be a lot of unhappy VCs out there because a lot of the companies that have started up over the last 5 years will become obsolete or worthless. There'll be hundreds of millions, if not billions of dollars of VC money left on the table. So you're fighting a huge amount of inertia to try to get something like that done.
Okay.
I was just going to say, I mean, to the point of sort of alignment around the industry, though, I think one of the challenges, for example, in a lot of these startups, and even the reference to walled gardens, is one of the biggest things that all of us, I think, universally care about is privacy and security. And increasingly, that's going to be an issue we cannot get away from. And so just in the balance of these things, I think a JIC is almost necessary in order for us to move forward.
On the measurement side, from a market cap point of view, you know, Nielsen plus Comscore together right now is sub $20 billion. And if you look at that in the context of the total media spend and what's not getting properly measured and captured, it's more than that already. So what do we have to lose?
Yeah. Well, and I don't think disrupting capital markets for the financial industry is a reason for the ad industry and the media industry not to move forward, but
not my problem.
Again, I'm not going to editorialize. So, but there are certainly a lot of great organizations like CIMM who are trying to move the ball forward. I just think it's a discussion unless we put it on paper. And if the biggest issues are standards, an industry collective could define the standards faster, or you could wait for the right marketplace solution to come along. Okay, so that was my rant. I'm going to go back into the script now. How does the shift to audience buying, we heard it on the last panel, and I think there was a lot of good solutions, but also problems, because they're measuring their own internal group, whether it's NBCU's solution or Viacom solution or whatever. They're great, but how does that lend itself to a true open source kind of view of cross-platform marketplace? And is there a way we can get there by stitching things together or coming up with a solution that allows a Viacom Plus or whatever to come together in a way. Do you have any ideas for how we could get to a future where we're not just measuring slices of a pie, but a total pie?
So I want to jump on this one, because I have an issue with the notion that we are slowly shifting to an audience-based buying model. Folks, I've been in this business for 25 years. I've been buying audiences for 25 years. They've been defined as demographics, but I've been buying audiences. And I pay a CPM that's guaranteed, again, when I was on the agency side, I pay a CPM that guaranteed me an audience. So the notion that this is all new is absurd. What we have is a different way to define audiences, and we have a different way to actually deliver the media. No longer in a unit, now at an impression level. So I think the question you're asking is actually two very different things. This notion of, are we moving to audience-based buying, it's irrelevant. We're just buying audiences and defining them differently. The notion of, does it change the way that we trade? Totally dependent on whether we have the ability to address at the household or the device level. And the vast majority of the TV business for the foreseeable future is going to continue to trade as units. It ain't moving to addressable advertising anytime soon. And there are a whole host of barriers that sit between today and us getting to that addressable future. Those are the intermediaries, the tech companies, the measurement solutions, the commercial agreements that all have to be figured out for national networks to be able to deliver impression-based advertising in the vast majority of their distribution. So we're nowhere close to that.
Yeah, I mean, I agree wholeheartedly that we have been doing it, and you're right, it's just a segmented approach versus a broad approach. And there's no question that we are far away from getting to it at huge scale. I think that there are, you know, the previous panel, there was, you know, the companies that I think are fundamentally moving faster in that direction, the Viacoms, the NBCs, the Turners, ABC as well, obviously, moving in that direction in terms of, you know, conceptually, that segmented approach versus the broad demo approach. But we have a long way to go, and, you know, we don't have a broadcast standard change for another 3 or 4 years, and then you need that adopted. You need that, you know, put into inventory systems and understanding how that affects your overall inventory. So there's a whole host of challenges, you know, and Adam laid it out really, really well, that kind of preclude that from being across scale and everything that we do. So we're not nowhere near that. Now, do we get to that eventually? I imagine we have to. I know as a buyer, even at a seller, right? I work at a seller, but I'm a buyer for the seller. I certainly think about that, right? And I think about that as I'm buying, whether I'm buying television or I'm buying digital, in terms of how do I want to approach it. But you know, we are fundamentally far away from that at like mass scale.
Which I think, I mean, look, it sort of depends what universe you're defining.
Well, digital is obviously a different story.
Well, except that it's not, right? So, you know, as we compete in the upfront, the challenge for you guys is, hey, how do I compare an impression? Which, by the way, you know, you guys are having more and more impressions as you want to count more and more of the digital TV, which you should, and should get value of that. And how do we sort of compare and manage that to a TV unit, right? Which has all sorts of measurement complications. And then, as the last panel alluded to, actually also behavioral and value differentiation. So one question I think is sort of, for how long can we wait to move forward on this?
But the challenges aren't on the TV side. To be very straightforward,
I'm saying the challenges are the brand.
The challenge is the fact that digital is not measured in a way that is at all in similar accurate terms as what we measure in TV. It doesn't factor in co-viewing. It doesn't factor in duration. It doesn't factor in a whole host of things that TV measurement for decades has accounted for. So, if digital wants to compete for TV dollars, it needs to move closer to a TV discipline.
I got to challenge that. I mean, I think you're sort of making that digital challenge. And you pointed out some of the places where, you know, there are tensions there. By counter, I would say we do differentiate between the first break and the last break, between being in an A pod position and sort of a middle pod position. And so we both have this challenge to try to help Coke figure out, you know, what's the value I get out of an impression on either one of these.
But digital isn't just representative of a singular environment, right? So great, that's fine for one environment. What about the other 5 billion environments that are part of that, right? And how do you account for that? And not to mention all the varying challenges of digital as regards to, you know, the viewability issue, fraud, and everything else. So there are you know, fundamental flaws in the way that, and I'm a digital person by nature, right? Yeah. But there are fundamental flaws to the way that digital is operating today that don't align with how I think it needs to work effectively to align to everything else in the marketplace.
Well, one way of looking at it also is that there's opportunity for traditional television and for traditional digital to both evolve. From a digital perspective, I think that there is a much needed evolution in the metrics which are used, which, as you pointed out, you know, there's been some really great metrics in TV for a while. Digital has been very innovative, developed a number of metrics, but there's still opportunity for improvement there. On the television side, obviously, lots of room for improvement in targetability, and lots of progress has been made there, but it's still much way to go there.
So just to continue down the sort of socialist measurement road that Joe happily started us out on earlier.
I think it's very capital oriented, but okay.
Well, no, but I mean, from a collaborative, from a process perspective, I think it is. And let's just say for the minute that the way we get TV and digital to get along is we posit that point out in the future and say, okay, post ATSC 3.0, post all the traffic and billing systems getting updated, post all the, you know, data targeting identity issues of how do I tell that this individual with this device is part of this household and executed this transaction that I want to measure as a KPI. Let's just say in 2023, we're going to have solved for all of those things. Let's work backward from 2023 and the vision of what that looks like when you roll it all together. And we'll all, from our different points of view, sort of work toward that. Might work.
I just want to follow up. I want to come to Tara's defense a little bit because I agree with her. And that question started with audience buying. And I don't agree with you, Adam, that what you've been doing all this time is audience buying. What you've been doing is indexing audiences and using demographic surrogates and other proxies to extrapolate an audience. True audience buying in the digital world, and I hate to even say that, in the world, means targeting the audience, the actual user, the identity of the person. You're the one.
It's somewhat semantics, yeah, no, though.
I think it's semantics. So listen, Joe, here's the reality, okay? What matters to the advertiser is the audience segment that they care about, okay?
The audience they care about.
Yes, the audience segment that they care about. Now, in traditional forms of television, okay, if an advertiser was buying adults 18 to 49, they were paying for adults 18 to 49. Everyone else they got, they weren't paying for. It was bonus. Okay, so the fact that I was over-delivering the advertiser because the platform on which I was delivering the media was incapable of addressing is irrelevant. The advertiser is getting the audience that they wanted, that they defined as the guarantee, right, for the price that they wanted. In the world of digital, they get the same exact thing, just without the waste. Theoretically, if the measurement and the targeting that's being used by the digital company is accurate. Now, they're getting the same audience. They're buying an audience in both cases. They're buying it for a set price. No difference. Actually, they're getting a better deal in television because they're getting a whole bunch of additional exposure that's helping their brand. So I would argue that we've been doing audience-based buying
maybe that exposure, for years. Maybe that exposure is helping their brand, and maybe it's not, right? I think if you're Coke, it's awesome. If you're SAP, which is one of our agency clients, eh.
I think the other thing that we should make a distinction on, and again, you know, even you see the challenge even in the use of the word digital, right? Because there are video platforms, irrespective of device distribution, et cetera, right? And there are platforms that have some video. So let's talk for a second about video platforms, right? Because, you know, I think the competitive set we all view together, right, tends to be TV, FEPs, Hulu, YouTube, right? So, you know, we don't have a lot of the problems you alluded to. It's 93% viewable, all that kind of stuff, and we have the precision you deliver. The reason I think we both have to move together, and again, the more you start to have ratings that are coming through digital, I think you guys are going to sort of evolve the same way out of interest, is that it's not because you're averaging, right? It's not always that you're getting exactly what you delivered in 18 to 49, right? You have no idea if you're the second or third person in the pod how much viewership you actually got. If you're, you know, when you see the curves, I mean, you know this better than I do, right? But if you're coming in at the back half of the hour versus the front half of the hour, you really don't know. Whereas in digital, you really do. And so there are advantages and disadvantages both ways. But I think the point is, how do we help brands?
Well, in digital, what I know is I got charged for an impression after it ran for 3 seconds or 2 seconds.
But that's
what I know in digital.
But let's even take that a step further. So,
well, that's not true on our platform.
But let's take that a step further. So, who's and is, I can't believe I'm actually doing this. Who is actually defining what the audience is? Right? Is it a third party? Right? And how does that work?
Right.
So I don't think that's you know, you could say, yeah, so you're definitely getting the audience you want. No, you're not. No, absolutely not. That's not 100% the case in every instance. And again, I'm not specifically talking about your platform. I'm just talking about in general, right? If I have a whole host of first-party data, I have a little bit more information on the segment and their behaviors to use. But if I'm using third-party data, well, there's gaps in there that I could punch holes in all day long. So it's not always the case that you're 100% getting what you want and always the case that you're getting the audience that you want. There are, and I think where we began this, right, there are no standard definitions of what is a Coca-Cola, like, you know, audience, right?
Well, they're Coca-Cola gonna have their, has one.
Well, no, I'm saying they have their DMP, right? And they're going to know that this from their own definition of that. But when they're prospecting and they have to use other data sets, right, to determine whether or not, you know, it's a prospective buyer, and probably bad definition because it's Coke. But at the end of the day, that's not exactly the case. You're not always getting the audience you want. There are tons and tons of gaps in digital data.
I think we're all on the quest, right? That's sort of my point. We are all on the quest to have, and look, we are aggressively partnering with pretty much everybody here, right? And all of the third parties out there to try to move this forward.
Sure.
To hit the common standards that you described earlier. My only point was it's not perfect in either dimension.
Nothing
that
perfect.
What we need, and therefore, as a result, what we need, and I think the reason
is more collaboration.
Room, yeah. Is more collaboration and more agreement on, like, what, to your point, what question are we trying to solve, and how do we get a common standard that addresses the value that is available across platforms? Right, that is what will maximize value for sellers and maximize value for brands and agencies.
I don't think you can get a common standard, though. I think so. This is where I think the conversation gets really tricky, and Joe, I'm sorry, I'm hijacking.
Oh, no, good stuff. I want to reconvene this as a MediaPost panel, because I think it should be its own conversation.
So I want to throw something out.
Spirited. That means you're an amazing moderator.
I think the mistake we all make is that we're trying to establish a standard value mechanism for a marketplace that's incredibly, incredibly complicated. What we really need to do is create a standard transactional unit, which I would argue we already have. It's called the impression, which is no different than a GRP. It's just a different way of expressing it. That's another thing that everyone gets all caught up in their underwear about. But the other side of the coin is how we value those impressions. Now, I would argue we need a standard for the impression. There can be a million different ways you want to value it. And the analogy is the stock market. Every company has shares of stock. Everyone knows what a share of stock is. But every company has a different float, different number of shares that they have in the marketplace. Every buyer and hedge fund and analyst evaluates companies differently. Some use cash flow, some use earnings per share, some use debt ratios. They use different mechanisms to value that company. Just like every advertiser, depending on their particular business, high consideration product, low consideration product, long purchase cycle, short purchase cycle, high price point, low price point, will use different mechanisms to value the impression that they want to buy. We need a standard way to define impressions, and everyone in this room can have 27 million different ways that they value it. And that should be the conversation that buyers and sellers have. On valuing the impression. That's the negotiation. But the impression is what we transact.
And ironically, that goes back to a conversation earlier today about attribution and the challenges that faces, right, and the marketplace faces in attribution to determine the value of certain things, of the impression.
Okay, well, we're running out of time. I didn't mean to go that deep into that debate, but it's a good subject. And I'm genuinely going to try and get you back at MediaPost. So But let's follow up on Adam's last point, because I think it is the heart of what we're talking about here, which is standardization and metrics and currency are all good words for it. I don't necessarily agree with you that impression is the right common denominator, because it's not the audience. But what do you all think the common metric should be? Can we have a common metric, or will it always be custom solutions retrofitting to a transactional impression? Come on, client. Come on, it's your money.
I think that there is some value to the notion of impression, okay? I'm not going to say that it is going to be the end-all, be-all. I don't tend to think that there is going to be one golden metric, but I would certainly be a little bit, I'm not ready to discount the idea of an impression. Okay. Now, impression coupled with other metrics to add richness to it, to add definition to it, makes a lot of sense.
That's exactly the direction I was going to head. I mean, and to go back to the stock market analogy, shares are great, but what if I don't want to invest in equities? I want to have bonds, or I want to buy real estate, or I want a boat because boats are awesome investments, as everyone knows. Just kidding. Or I want to stuff a bunch of gold under the floor of my cabin in the woods. And I think, you know, we have to think about what constitutes success for an advertiser who's, at the end of the day, money it is that's being spent. And impressions are one currency, if you will, one standard way to look at that. But I think there are lots of other important KPIs. And again, you know, the just the variance of value of an impression against a target versus not a, versus outside of that target is wildly different if you're selling soft drinks or enterprise software.
Well, yeah, it's fair. Not all impressions are equal. If I'm spending more time with that impression, there's got to be some intrinsic value there, right? And if
not
I'm engaging, not necessarily, I'm saying there has to be some intrinsic value there, and what is that? If I'm engaging with that impression, then that also has some kind of intrinsic value. So, and that's going to be dependent on the advertiser and how they're determining ROI, right? And that's that's the gap that I think we're overall kind of missing, is that everybody's determination of ROI and every advertiser's determination of ROI is going to be different inherently, right? Because it's going to make sense for their business. So, you know, there is the reality of how do we kind of get to a singular form of transaction, as Adam says, which is exactly what we have to do. You can't solve for every individual advertiser in 19 different ways. You have to have some singular form of transactional scenario before you get to now the advertiser having additional data sets to determine the value of what that transaction was and whether or not I want to continue to invest further in that impression, right, or that publisher that's delivering that impression. That's the trick, but it does have to come down to some level of simplicity to make the transaction happen, and then on the back end, you make the determination of the value of that.
So in 7 minutes, how do we create a universal impression metric?
If I had that answer, I wouldn't be here. I'd be on.
I vote for the
Dick. Silicon Valley.
I'd be in Silicon Valley, worth a lot more.
Okay, we'll move on. A lot of what we've been talking about on the side here has been the communications values or the environmental weights of some platforms, i.e. TV, versus other platforms. And I've heard a lot of knocks about time span, viewability, and things like that. How do we get around standardizing what we mean by an impression being served across these environments or platforms? Let's use the word platforms. That's why we're here today.
I mean, look, I think there's a lot of good work that's already being done by a couple of different industry groups. There's the work the MRC is doing in conjunction with the IAB. There's work that the DCN is doing. You know, I think it all ultimately comes down to the fact that digital and television have kind of grown up at different times and with different. You know, digital started out as a different type of medium than what television started out as. And so the metrics that were initially born in the late 90s, early 2000s were much more performance driven. And I think it's going to take some time for the segment of the digital industry that wants to play in the brand space, that wants to play in the TV marketplace, to evolve. And I don't disagree that television has to move towards some of the digital principles as well. And I think the work that's being done by the industry bodies is trying to tackle some of that. I mean, duration is the biggest piece of that calculation. The biggest discrepancy between the two worlds of measurement between digital and television today is one is duration weighted and factors in duration, and the other does not.
Well, and I do think we step into it. Go ahead.
Well, duration, there's a macro. I agree with you. I mean, there's a lot of good work being done by a lot of the folks in this room. And I think the challenge we're going to have to get past collectively is not any of the sort of technical nature of it, because we could work that out. And especially, again, you know, as there are video platforms, whether they originate in TV or originate from digital, that look and feel the same to users, there will be commonality around that. But the reason, and the reason duration sort of strikes a chord, the reason I think we're going to struggle and we just have to come together and figure out how do we work through it is we fundamentally have different businesses. Like, viewers actually are not experiencing our video experiences necessarily so differently in most instances, but our business models are different and our measurement associated with that are different because TV has always been about aggregating as many viewers as possible around one big piece of content, right, and continuing to do that, whereas digital is about aggregating audiences around lots of pieces of content. And therefore, when you talk about duration, you quickly get into duration of content, duration of ad. You know, there's a whole bunch of things that come out of that, and that's why we need either the JIC or the lock in the room to figure it out. But I think we need to sort of be honest with ourselves here, but that is the heart of what is sort of driving some of the challenges.
I think we step into a massive landmine if we start including duration in the currency
yeah.
of it versus using it as a determining factor of the value. There's a very fundamental difference there, right?
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
like, because all of a sudden, it's like, what do I pay for 10 seconds, 11 seconds, 12 seconds, 13?
Well, and there's so many yeah. factors.
It becomes untenable yeah. from yeah. a trading perspective. Yeah. And I know a lot of traders and planners, and none of them are rocket scientists.
Yeah.
So I'm one myself, so yeah. So, yeah. you know, like that's a challenge. But to determine value, that's a different story. Then there is some intrinsic value to kind of each advertiser to determine how much that potential duration period has an impact on their business. And only they know that because they have the back-end sales.
Yeah.
So we'll never get to a time spent per impression type currency, but maybe it would be too dangerous. All right, we have 3 minutes. So I'm going to ask one kind of toss-up question here. I was struck in the last panel when Howard was talking about the need to have a meta view so you could start to see like the audiences you're losing to Netflix, Amazon, and Hulu. But today, there's a lot of audience that's not even being measured in linear TV that's not being accounted for. And there's a ton of audience that's not even being measured in digital, depending on how we define it. So do we really want to capture all of the cross-platform video measurement that's going on in the marketplace, or do we only want to come up with a better system for measuring the high premium branded kind of content that we're talking about on this stage?
Well, I don't know. It needs to be an either or, okay? It needs to be both, okay? We need to be greedy, okay? We need to pursue both. But I cannot understate the importance of being able to advance the ball down the field for cross-platform measurement.
And I think a lot of that comes down to, and I think this is sort of where Howard was going too, you need something like a universe estimate. You need to know what is the world within which the premium stuff you care a lot about exists. And until you know that, you don't know what it's competing with and where attention is flowing and what's going to be the next premium place that you want to be.
Yeah, at MediaPost, we created something a couple of years ago called the Unique User Index. And I was shocked when I really dug into digital that nobody had a universe estimate for how many uniques you were reaching. Is it a great index? We think it's pretty good, but you know, I don't know why people don't glom onto that kind of thing and come up with a universal metric for what the universe of users are out there. And then within that, look at TV or nonlinear TV or digital or other impressions. Is that a good idea? Let's close with that. Come up with a
I think it's a good idea if you do it in a consistent way. And look, you know, the problem with digital is that we've looked at things on a unique user basis monthly.
That's
it
wrong.
Factors yeah. nothing. Yeah. It doesn't factor in anything with regards to the amount of time.
We're doing it daily.
Yeah. Okay. But you have to do it consistently across platform. If you don't build the universe estimates and you don't build the measurement solutions holistically across platform, you can't use them to compare and or to estimate the marketplace. And so I think that's what the problem is. We'll get there, but it's going to take time.
Is it a cookie base? Is it a registered user? Yeah. I mean, like, there's a lot of fundamental...
It's a user.
Yeah, it has to be, right? And therefore, you need some commonality to determine across multiple platforms who that user is on a daily basis.
Well, I think what that router project that ComScore is working on is a good step in that direction, because you'll have a universal view of a subset of an audience. And I think it was Kate or whomever encouraged ComScore to be more aggressive in rolling that out. That could be an interesting insight. We don't take any questions. Oh, we do take questions. Okay, good.
Have some questions?
In this day and age, how could we possibly not know the question of what we're doing here? How can we not know that? How can there be any question about the fact that we're looking for cross-platform measurement? Why are we asking such fundamental questions?
Yeah. I should have opened with that.
We know what the question is. Yeah. Look, the problem is it's hard to actually execute the measurement. For anyone on the publisher side in the room, and I think a couple of the panels hit it earlier today, Julian will appreciate this, and probably Tara as well, because I think they deal with it at Google. Implementing SDKs and tags across different platforms, different operating systems, is just, it's not a scalable solution for us as publishers. Already hit it the nail on the head earlier when he said we need less intrusive mechanisms for measuring the marketplace. The problem with publisher implementation of these measurement solutions is, number one, not everyone's going to do it, so you're never going to have a marketplace view. Number two, the people who do it, some of them are going to do it incorrectly, so the data is going to be wrong. The third problem is the fraudsters, the people who are bad actors, are going to do it the wrong way on purpose to make their media look bigger than it really is. And there's no policing mechanism to make sure the data's right. The beauty of the existing measurement solutions, as bad as everyone thinks they are, Nielsen, MRI, any panel-based service, is that it's a panel, it's controlled, and the measurement company knows exactly what's being measured. And it's done consistently for everyone, so it's consistently wrong or consistently good. But in a world of SDKs and publisher side implementation, we lose all that. We don't have a marketplace view, we have bad data, and in the end, the folks who suffer the most are the advertisers, because they don't get the value out of the media, out of the quality publisher platforms that they expect.
So again, in the imagine the future, I don't know how many are familiar with a company called Segment. What they do is actually provide a measurement API, collect data, and then allow you as the publisher or anyone else you want to share it with to get access to that same data set. And I think if we're going to have publisher-based data collection based on SDKs, it has to be one standard one and controls on where that data goes that allow for measurement of everything from standardization of what the units are to control of fraud. And I know that what I just proposed creates a really super creepy data set, and that's a conversation for another day.
Look, the announcement you made, Jane, your ID should be the centerpiece. An open standard ID should be the centerpiece of whatever measurement company works off of, so that publishers implement once, and that's it.
Agreed.
I do think, though, that some of what's also being highlighted is also where Julian started on why we haven't been successful with a JIC, right, which is that a lot of these things can all be solved. They really can. It's an alignment of business interest issue that we have to collectively work to. And I know we are incredibly committed to doing that. And I think, as I said earlier, I think our partners either are or increasingly will be, because this is where the world is going and it's forcing alignment of those
things. Yeah, I mean, that's the fundamental gap, right? We can have a solution. It's that as much as everybody says they want one, I don't know that everybody does.
Hi, Tony Jarvis, Olympic Media Consultancy. We already have tremendous cooperation between a lot of the major players, Nielsen with Facebook, ComScore actually purchased Rentrak. And interestingly, we had the Canadians down from up in Toronto at the Cold North where I used to live. And while, yes, you know, ultimately maybe a JIC is the is the answer to most people in the world, they presented the idea of a tripartite, not-for-profit cooperative. And it seems we're kind of on the way there. And if we embraced, Adam, if we embraced the same definition of impression across all media, which I would suggest would be eyes on or ears, it would be ad exposure, not value, not impact, because then the creative comes in and the brand equity, da, 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 da. But if through a joint industry cooperative, Tara, we all agreed, we're in that hot room, and we agreed to a single definition of impression that would be a common trading currency to which we would all add other data and put our value thing there, I think we can jump this industry way ahead of where we even dare believe it could be.
So who's for the tripartite nonprofit cooperative?
Can we meet at Google? They're the best cafeteria.
We would be happy to have you.
If you're so what is that? Is that Facebook, place, Google, and everyone else? Is that the tripartite?
From the NFL. My question is based on this total audience, cross media, total audience, platform, ratings, whatever you have it, get in a room, that's great, but content is different. Sports is different than news,
yes.
Different than scripted series. Are we thinking about measuring it across those instead of across the total? Because there's different sponsorships, the way we sell it is differently. Mm-hmm. So I didn't know if you had any thoughts on that.
Well, some of that gets back to a difference in value that you extract from those different genres or that different type of programming, okay, as opposed to how it is actually measured. I mean, certainly we like the idea of rich tagging so we understand exactly what, so that we can slice and dice impressions a variety of different ways. But I would differentiate between, between trying to micro segment along genre lines and then leave it up to the individual advertisers and the agencies to figure out the value to assign to each of them.
I think if you start micro segmenting, you're going to fall into a death spiral of everybody starting to define micro segments and adding micro segments and everything that goes along with it. It's never going to be as simple as news, sports, scripted. It'll start getting variable, especially as you're talking about from a digital perspective, and it's going to open up another, you know, 500 different ways to kind of value that. So I think there is a definition of that, and then the value of what you're doing and what you're getting out of it is going to determine how much you're willing to pay for it.
And I think to the point about sort of sponsorships and integrations, that kind of integrated marketing experience is exactly the reason why impressions by themselves don't answer the real question.
Yes. 100%. Mm-hmm.
I think we're going to.
Yeah. That was a good question to close with. Great. We didn't talk about communications value enough, but I think we solved the problem on a universal metric, right? I mean,
yeah. Okay.